Thank you for joining us this afternoon. I'm Jim Pomerantz, Professor of Psychology and Director of Scientia, and this is our fifth lecture of the academic year in a series that we hope you're finding rewarding and memorable. One whose theme, perhaps a bit unsettling, is entitled Conflict, Violence, and War. We are fortunate indeed to have as our speaker today one of Rice's most exciting new faculty members to come our way in some time, Kristen Osterr from the Department of English. It'll be my pleasure to introduce her to you in just a moment. But first, it's been a long break, so let's refresh our memories on where we stand. The theme for this year's symposium, Conflict, Violence, and War, was developed, as always, by a committee of faculty headed this year by David Queller of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology. You can read more about this theme on our program cards or on our website, where you can find out more about our speakers, including those yet to appear in this year's series. So to refresh our memories, let me quote from our program description, which says, "The desire for peace and tranquility may run deep in the human spirit, but conflict, violence, and war have been nearly ubiquitous hallmarks of our past. This year's series will examine the nature and origin of conflicts, not only in modern-day warfare and throughout human history, but in its evolutionary roots within other animal species. By examining a spectrum extending from the appearance of violence in images, that would be today's talk, to the occurrence of competition versus cooperation in experimental gaming and bargaining experiments, that would be Rick Wilson's talk coming up next month, we'll examine the causes and possible purposes of violent behavior, as well as what might be done to contain violence in the future." So, following on that, we'll be resuming our schedule in February with a talk by Rick Wilson of Political Science on February 15th, and then seated, as it turns out, right next to Rick, we'll have a talk from Dave Schneider in Psychology on April 19th. We're in the final stages of planning our external speaker who will deliver the Bochner lecture, so watch this space. We should have an announcement out to you very soon. So I think I can say with confidence that we have another exciting and engaging spring semester in store for you at Scientia. I'm also pleased to announce another event that's closely linked to Scientia, and that is the DeLang Conference. For those of you who don't know, the DeLang Conference is Rice's premier conference program that every few years hosts a multi-day program on the Rice campus dealing really with any pressing area within academe. The next DeLang Conference, the fifth, is going to be held here on campus March 7th through 9th over in the Shepherd School, Alice Pratt Brown building, on the topic of frontiers of medicine, society, pharmacology, and membrane biology in the genomic era. Membrane biology may sound a bit of a narrow or specialized topic, but let me assure you that it's extremely exciting, and it is the future of medicine in the view of many, if not most. And we try in the DeLang Conference to ensure that, particularly in the first day of the conference, there's a strong link between the science and public policy general interest component. So we have an array of speakers featuring Nobel laureates, distinguished people from other continents, including a baroness, Susan Greenfield from England, so try to put that down on your schedule. We have plenty of brochures here, and you can also find that on the web at delang.rice.edu. So before I introduce Kristen, let me note the format. She'll speak for about the normal 50 to 60 minutes, varying inversely with the duration of my introduction, as always. Then we'll have the usual 15 minutes or so for question and answers, followed by wine and cheese reception, directly outside in the foyer. And now for the reason why we're here today, to hear from Kristen Osterr of the English Department. By way of background, she received her bachelor's degree, Phi Beta Kappa, in fact, from Reed College, and then moved on to work on her PhD, master's and PhD at Brown University in their well-known Department of American Civilization. After she received her PhD in 2001, she became a postdoctoral fellow in the faculty seminar on transnational intersections of gender, race, ethnicity, class, and sexuality at Wesleyan University. And from there, she moved in July of 2002 to join us here at Rice. In her brief time since her PhD, she's been extremely productive in her scholarship. She's published several articles in the magazine named Plasm, that's with a Z, which is a memorably named publication that tells us it features the work of artists, musicians, designers, architects, capitalists, anarchists, printmakers, paper shredders, snowboarders, and stargazers. She's published an article in CineLit, essays on peninsular film and fiction, a piece on the film Mulholland Drive in Senses of Cinema, an article on the cinema of world health in Camera Obscura, a chapter in a book, Cultural Sutures, Morals, Medicine, and Media, published last year, and probably the most exciting project, her new book, which is due out this year from Duke University Press, entitled Cinematic Prophylaxis, Globalization, Contagion, and World Health. Not resting on those laurels, she's undertaken another book project, which is in the works, entitled Contagion and the Nation, Surveillance, Imaging, and the Practice of Public Health. With all the references to film and to cinema and cameras obscura, it's probably not surprising that Kristen's interest is in particular on images. And that interest will in turn lead her to talk about visual representations of violence and to share with us her interpretation of the role of violence in American entertainment. So as always, let me ask you to turn off your cell phones, your pagers, and anything else that makes noise and tune in to Kristen Osterr, whose title is Violence in the Mass Media. Kristen.
Well, thank you for the kind introduction, and thanks to all of you for coming. Violence in the mass media is a pretty juicy topic, especially since it usually comes paired with the topic of sex. And it has been a juicy topic since the earliest days of cinema. Starting in the first decade of the 20th century, social guardians have been concerned with the effects of graphic representations of sex and violence on viewers. Initially, this concern was driven by the widely held belief that certain segments of the viewing population were especially vulnerable to the seductive qualities of the new medium. Not surprisingly, in the early decades of the 20th century, this vulnerable group consisted mainly of women, immigrants, and children. Many reformers feared that the supposed mental immaturity of these viewers would render them incapable of distinguishing between representation and reality, and therefore they would be unduly influenced by any depictions of immoral activity, whether it were bank robbery at gunpoint or the glamorous nightlife of kept women. Eventually, these concerns led to the development of an elaborate system of regulation or censorship, depending on your point of view, called the Production Code, which governed and restricted the content of American movies from 1930 to 1968. The different types of violent representations that were produced before, during, and after the Production Code provide an important historical context for the debates about violent or otherwise inappropriately graphic representation today. Now, while there are numerous fascinating intersections between the representations of sex and violence, I will not be talking much about sex today, although it will appear in several of the clips that I'm showing. I'll be spending the majority of my talk developing a framework that I hope will prove useful for thinking about the role of visual media in the war in Iraq in the context of the history of attempts to regulate the production and distribution of violent images in U.S. film and television in general. To place the television coverage of the war in perspective, I'll provide an overview with clips of the different definitions and modes of representing violence in film and television in the US in three periods: before 1930, between 1930 and 1966, and from 1967 onward, concluding with examples from recent controversies. So one of the questions that I ask in the abstract for this talk is whether the public reaction to representations of violence depends at all on who is perpetrating the violence and who is the victim. The short answer is yes, but the longer answer involves a discussion of both cultural norms and genre conventions. To elaborate on this point, my first example will be drawn from a film that I'm sure most of you have heard of, and perhaps many of you have seen, D.W. Griffith's 1915 film, The Birth of a Nation. Much has been said about this film, but I want to focus on two aspects: its stylistic innovations and the responses that were generated by the film's treatment of racial violence. Prior to 1915, most films were one reel long. That's 10 to 16 minutes, and they were shown in Nickelodeons or as part of vaudeville shows, but not in legitimate theaters. These films had minimal narrative development, no character development, and quite simple camera work and editing. Scenes were usually shot in one take from a fixed camera position and a fixed focal length. Birth of a Nation changed all of this. D.W. Griffith innovated the editing technique known as cross-cutting or parallel editing, and that's cutting between two lines of action to imply that they're happening simultaneously. And he was the first to use close-ups for dramatic or symbolic emphasis. In addition, the film showed in legitimate theaters, charged a $2 admission fee rather than the nickel usually associated with Nickelodeons. It had a running time of over an hour, a sophisticated narrative structure, at least some complex characters, elaborate battle scenes that were staged on a vast scale, and complex camera setups that enabled single scenes to be comprised of multiple shots. In addition to these technical and aesthetic innovations, the film's fame was also indebted to its claim of historical veracity. President Woodrow Wilson famously described the film as history written in lightning, and the film's ability to impress many of its viewers with its seeming authenticity was based in no small part on its stylistic sophistication. Now, while many viewers and critics were praising the film for all of the reasons I've indicated, many others objected strongly to the film's content and its political message. For those of you unfamiliar with this film, it essentially depicts the Civil War and Reconstruction as leading to chaos, mayhem, and immorality, especially exemplified by the acquisition of equal rights by freed slaves, which leads directly to the threat of interracial marriage. Of course, this desire is represented as a threat posed by black men to white women, and the rescue of white womanhood and the entire nation is performed by the Ku Klux Klan. And I want to show you the first clip right now from Birth of a Nation, if you can roll that.
Thank you.
Okay, so in this sequence and throughout the film, the sexual thread is dramatized through the technique of parallel editing, which you saw here with the ride to the rescue happening simultaneously with the attack. The multiple rides to the rescue are intercut with the woman under assault. In the end, the Ku Klux Klan saves the white South from Northern Reconstruction and the black sexual assault. But the film also implicitly reveals that white sexual desire is as responsible for the racial violence perpetrated by the Klan as the black sexual desire that the Klan is supposedly avenging. Now, social reformers were already concerned with the negative effects of movie viewing by 1915. But some progressive era reformers wanted to use film as an educational medium, a vehicle for uplifting the masses, and especially as a universal language for Americanizing immigrants. But Birth of a Nation was seen by these viewers as racial bigotry, not as uplift, and thus the film was condemned quite widely. The NAACP demanded that the most blatantly racist scenes be cut, which included a scene depicting the castration of an African-American character named Gus, and the film's concluding proposal that all African-Americans be deported back to Africa. Many different versions of the film circulated for years after 1915, including some that had edited out the most offensive scenes. The version of the film that's usually seen today has these scenes omitted, but almost any contemporary viewer of Birth of a Nation would still find the film shockingly and violently racist. This is in part due to social changes in US culture since the film was produced, but it is also due to the specific types of censorship that the film was subjected to. Some of the scenes that were removed from Birth of a Nation were quite graphic, violent, and offensive, but they were also historically accurate in their depiction of the extent of white racial violence against blacks. In contrast, some of the scenes that were left in the film depicting violence or attempted violence by black men against white women are clearly the products of a long-standing fantasy about the supposed racial aggression of black male sexuality that served to legitimate racial oppression. So in the censorship of this film, the representations of black sexual violence were deemed appropriate and historically accurate, but the depictions of white racial violence were not. This raises a question about what kinds of violence are considered to be deserving of censorship and what kinds pass as acceptable, or who is allowed to perpetrate violence and who is not. Moreover, this film poses the problematic question of what ends are served by the censorship of violent imagery when only certain acts of violence are deemed unacceptable. The technical sophistication of Birth of a Nation dramatically enhanced its persuasiveness, and it gave it the status of a masterpiece, at least for audiences that were disposed to accept its point of view. And indeed, the film did have an instructional effect, but of exactly the opposite sort from that which the reformers of the period espoused. The film has been directly linked to the modern revival and expansion of the Ku Klux Klan in the teens and 1920s. And the film was used as a KKK recruitment tool as late as the 1960s. But it's important to note that the film's use of melodrama and sentimentality made it exceptionally powerful even for viewers who wouldn't have gone to the extremes of supporting or joining the Klan. So based on this example, it seems that the pro-censorship formers were clearly correct in their assumption that motion pictures have a powerful effect on their viewers. And it was this same assumption that prompted the NAACP to demand cuts in the film. This presumption is something that has defined the history of film regulation, which has, in turn, had a tremendous effect on shaping the form and content of movies as they developed over the past century. So the kinds of violent imagery that were included in Birth of a Nation were clearly subject to criticism by reform groups, but they were not subject to any larger system of censorship. Until the early 1930s, the opponents of Hollywood had consisted primarily of Christian religious leaders, and women's organizations who claimed, as self-appointed guardians of public morality, that Hollywood was directly responsible for many of the dramatic changes that had taken place in American society since the motion picture was invented. Alarmed at an increasing divorce rate, a rise in juvenile delinquency, and what they saw as a general flaunting of traditional values by American youth, the reformers blamed the movies for the nation's moral collapse. The ministers and women's organizations considered themselves experts on obscenity, claiming that although they could not define it, they knew it when they saw it. And in the case of movies, anything they saw on screen that offended their sense of propriety, whether it was social, political, or moral in nature, was defined as obscene and deserved to be banned. The production code and its supporters wanted Hollywood's films to emphasize that the church, the government, and the family were the cornerstones of an orderly society, and that success and happiness resulted from respecting and working in this system. They believed that entertainment films, because of their powerful and widespread influence, had a duty to reinforce religious teachings that deviant behavior, whether criminal or sexual, cost violators the love and comforts of home, the intimacy of family, the solace of religion, and the protection of law. In short, they believed films should be 20th century morality plays that illustrated proper behavior to the masses. As the authors of the 1930 Production Code viewed Hollywood's responsibility, films were first and foremost entertainment for the multitudes, and as such carried a special moral responsibility, requisite of no other medium of entertainment or communication. Unlike the audience self-selectivity of books, plays, and newspapers, the universal popularity of the movies cut across social, political, and economic classes and penetrated communities from the most sophisticated to the most remote. Therefore, the universality of the movies meant that filmmakers could not be permitted the same freedom of expression allowed to the other media of communication. And in fact, films were not covered by the First Amendment until 1952. Movies had to be more restricted because the picture palaces and the beautiful, glamorous stars combined to create what was seen as an ultimate fantasy that was more persuasively and indiscriminately seductive than the illusions produced by other media. In 1928, when synchronized sound was added to the striking visual images, a sensation was created that film reform advocates believed would be irresistible to the impressionable minds of children, the uneducated, the immature, and the unsophisticated. To film censors and reformers, synchronized sound raised cinema's potential realism in dangerous ways. Explicit dialogue about contemporary social themes, including the affairs of gangsters and loose women, was perceived as a threatening source of instruction in criminal immorality. And the popular gangster and gold digger genres received a great deal of attention from anti-vice reformers. Because the talkies could convey more explicit suggestions of impropriety than silent films through racy dialogue, double entendres, and so forth, the technological development of synchronized sound raised the ire of moral reformers and social scientists alike, leading to endless tirades about the effects of motion pictures on various vulnerable audiences, most notably the nation's immigrant youth. In fact, children and uneducated laborers did represent a large percentage of the national film audience, and because this massive demographic was believed incapable of distinguishing between fantasy and reality, industry self-regulation or external control was deemed necessary. This resulted in the adoption of the Production Code of 1930, which advocated a focus on uplifting stories of business, industry, and commerce, and biographies of American heroes, sports figures, and political leaders in place of stories of gangsters and kept women. Amidst the widespread criticism of immorality in movies, the first rigorous social scientific studies in motion pictures were undertaken in an attempt to provide empirical evidence of the physiological and psychological impact of film viewing on youth. A central note of inquiry was the spectator's ability to distinguish reality from fiction in the movie viewing experience. But various conceptions of the psychological effects of movie viewing were already in circulation long before the topic became the subject of scientific inquiry. Significantly, the federal government's involvement in film production for both military and civilian training during World Wars I and II was motivated by the assumption that motion picture viewing constituted an ideal scenario for both logistical and ideological instruction. But while the government viewed the spectator's suggestibility as essential to their training, especially in the context of military training films, the film reform movement viewed this vulnerability as cause for alarm. The occasion for censorship was regarded as an opportunity for moral contamination. And implicit in the reformers' assumption that motion pictures have identifiable effects on their viewers was a theory not only of the relationship between film and conduct, but also of the relationship between film and history. Rather than passively reflecting a historical period, films were thought to actively shape the course of history by controlling the behavior of moviegoers in a model of spectatorship that imagined the Hollywood moguls conspiring to control the audience by injecting them with a potent dose of propaganda as they sat in the dark. While the Production Code of 1930 aimed to minimize screen violence, this early version of the code lacked any enforcement mechanisms, and inevitably, some films and filmmakers pushed the boundaries of what was deemed acceptable. The gangster film cycle of the early 1930s, in particular, inflamed national controversy about the unwholesome effects of the movies. These films were Little Caesar, which came out in 1930, The Public Enemy in 1931, and especially Scarface in 1932, which showed cold-blooded murder by Tommy gun. And these pictures boasted an extraordinary body count, especially in comparison to films that had come out before. But as you will see, even the films that were flagrant violations of the production code seem quite tame in comparison with today's standards. So here's a clip from Scarface.
All right, boss. The copper's gone.
All right, come on.
Hey, little boy.
You go around the back, up on the balcony. Grandstand seat, understand? Hey, Pedro. Side door. He may have friends. You never can tell. Joe, I want you to stand at the alley. If he gets that far, you do this stuff. You keep the motor running. Bring the present. You stay here. Come on, fellas.
Ah, now we'll know what happened with that girl instead.
Hey, Uncle. Did she take the guy with his collar?
No. She climbed back in the hay with the army.
Yeah?
That's fine. She's a smart girl, that's it.
Come on.
Yeah, what is going on?
So you can see in this clip that the violence itself takes place quite elegantly off screen in this sequence. And as film scholar Stephen Prince has argued, this and this clip demonstrates, under the production code, the pictorial treatment of violent crime glosses the scene's exceptional brutality by hiding its details. A viewer has to look through the style to grasp the content that it has buried. Now, although this film does include some scenes that depict graphic, direct shootings, they're still presented in a fairly sanitized manner. So this is what was considered excessive violence in 1932. But still, the violence of this cycle and the viciousness personified in the gangster heroes helped instigate the Production Code Administration, which was established in 1934 to enforce the regulations that were set forth in the Production Code of 1930. As well as the Pain Fund studies, the first systematic effort to use social science methodologies to study the effects of motion pictures on their audiences. Conducted in the early 1930s in response to controversies over allegedly indecent film content, the studies comprised 8 volumes of research on the effects of movies on children and youth, with particular emphasis on issues of delinquency and sexuality. As a result of their investigations of the boundaries between fantasy and reality, the social scientists conducting the Pain Fund studies determined not only that the majority of motion pictures redefined realism along dangerous lines by naturalizing immoral criminal activities, but also that viewers tended to imitate the version of reality that they saw on screen. This was the first fully articulated version of mass media behavioral effects theory, and it set the tone for many studies to follow. One of the key concepts that came out of these studies was that of emotional possession. As defined in a study titled Movies, Delinquency, and Crime, I'm quoting here, certain types of motion pictures may indirectly influence delinquent and criminal behavior by inducing emotional possession, the inciting of impulses, the arousing of a given emotion, a relaxing of ordinary control, and so an increased readiness to yield to the impulses aroused. These states of mind and feeling come usually as a result of the individual losing himself in the picture or becoming deeply preoccupied with its drama or movement, end quote. In this scenario, the spectator is unconsciously infected by the emotions displayed on screen and later exhibits the symptoms of contamination by reenacting the contaminating scene itself. So the Pain Fund researchers feared that repeated outbreaks of this form of excitement could develop into a permanent and detrimental behavior pattern in which individuals would consistently view herself or himself in the role of the gold digger or the gangster, acting in accord with that character type. This loss of distance between subject and object, self and other, was seen as an indirect way in which the movies were a cause of immorality and crime. For the Pain Fund studies, it is the physiological manifestation of emotion, the possibility of losing control of one's body, that imbues the movie viewing experience with such intense and therefore dangerous consequences. As we will see, the threatened loss of distance between the viewer and film has increasingly come to define the ways that the dangers of mass media violence are understood. The expanded production code of 1934 contained a new requirement that films with plot lines that depended on crime or sin must contain compensating moral value to justify the representation of immoral activities. As Gregory Black has explained, this meant that these films must have a good character who spoke as a voice for morality, a character who clearly told the criminals or sinner that he or she was wrong. Each film must contain a stern moral lesson, regeneration, suffering, and punishment. The code was intended to unilaterally purify the movies, regardless of the specific immorality that they might contain. Thus, the obscure requirement written into the code that nothing subversive of the fundamental law of the land could be depicted on screen. Instead, Hollywood movies would promote social spirit and patriotism and not confuse audiences with a cynical contempt for conventions, nor too vivid a recreation of the realism of problems encountered in life. But it was precisely the demand for a closer connection between the world according to Hollywood and the world outside that eventually forced dramatic changes in both film and television, particularly in the context of the Vietnam War. From the 1930s until 1968, filmmakers had to shoot and cut their material with the code's provisions in mind because the major studios would not distribute films that lacked a code seal of approval. The code regulated all aspects of screen content with an elaborate list of rules outlining what was permissible to show and what was not. These regulations placed great constraints on filmmakers and helped to prevent the emergence of extreme violence in American film during these earlier periods. In filmic depictions of crime, for example, the code stipulated that brutal killings must not be shown in detail, murder must not be glamorized so as to inspire imitation, and the use of firearms should be sparing. The beginning of the shift to a more graphic representation of physical violence took place in the late 1960s as a consequence of changes to the production code that were themselves a response to changes in American culture overall. In September 1966, the production code was revised, and in 1968, it was essentially replaced by the creation of the Code and Rating Administration with its GMRX classification scheme, and this is the original form of the rating system that we have today. Up to this point, movies had been governed by a document that reflected cultural values of the 1930s, and while those values may have seemed relevant through the victory culture of World War II, the violent cultural upheaval of the civil rights and anti-Vietnam War movements had no connection to the generally clean-cut and sanitized world of Hollywood. As the studio system collapsed, European art films entered the US market, and movies became more daring under the protection of free speech, the Hollywood industry mounted an aggressive campaign to make films relevant again for a society whose attitudes and practices no longer coincided with the morality institutionalized in the production code. A key part of this campaign was the creation of a new suggested for mature audiences designation for films that had harder, more adult content. This new designation enabled filmmakers for the first time to target an adult audience and on that basis take sex and violence much further than in the past when the audience mix included young viewers. And it's an important point of the production code that those films were meant to be appropriate for all age levels, for any viewer at all. These new films aim to reach the vital youth demographic, especially after a 1968 Motion Picture Association of America audience survey showed that 16 to 24-year-olds were responsible for 48% of national ticket sales. To capture this audience, the Hollywood studios believed that films would have to become more attuned to contemporary mores, particularly when the war in Vietnam convinced many filmmakers that movie violence paled next to the real-life bloodshed in the nation's cities and the jungles of Southeast Asia. The savage bloodshed of the Vietnam War established a context whereby filmmakers felt justified in reaching for new levels of screen violence. Moreover, the war and the political assassinations of the 1960s seemed to feed a general cultural fascination with violence to which the movies responded. In the same period, television was becoming an important site of violent imagery, particularly through television news coverage of the Vietnam War. Many media scholars have argued that the availability of color television footage of casualties of war and political protests, especially when seen in the intimacy of one's own home, galvanized many viewers who would not have otherwise joined protest movements. Meanwhile, television entertainment itself was trying to become more relevant by tentatively broaching political topics in programs that had previously maintained resolute denial of any real-world problems. But the real turning point came with the release of two films in 1967, Bonnie and Clyde and The Dirty Dozen. The Dirty Dozen was directed by Robert Aldrich, and it's about a group of convicted criminals who were rounded up during World War II to infiltrate Nazi Germany and murder the party leadership. The film was condemned for its glorification of killing and for blatantly appealing to the audience's aggressive and sadistic appetites. But Bonnie and Clyde went much farther by explicitly portraying the details and physicality of violent death, concluding with an extended slaughter sequence that shows the outlaws raked with automatic weapons fire, their bodies riddled with bullet strikes. Both Time and Newsweek condemned the film as bloodthirsty trash in initial reviews, only to issue retractions in an unprecedented second round of reviews that praised the picture as trendsetting. The techniques that Arthur Penn used in this film established what would quickly become the normative style for filming violent gun battles. He used multi-camera filming, that is, filming with more than one camera running simultaneously, and with the cameras running at different film speeds, slow motion and montage editing, that is, building a sequence out of many short, brief shots. And then, crucially, Penn added the use of squibs as a special effects tool. Now, for those of you who might be unfamiliar with this term, squibs were condoms filled with fake blood that were hidden within an actor's clothing and wired to detonate to simulate bullet strikes and blood sprays. Squibs enabled filmmakers to graphically visualize the impact of bullets on the human body, a detailing that is absent in film prior to 1967, and which helped give violence in these earlier periods an unreal and sanitized appearance. And here's the famous concluding sequence from Bonnie and Clyde. Note the use of squibs.
Get back here in about 20 minutes,
and we'll pick him up.
I tell you, if that boy didn't have his head strapped on him, he'd lose it.
Hey.
So, as you can see from this clip, there's a pretty huge change from Scarface to here. Bonnie and Clyde and the Dirty Dozen clearly indicated the trend for future filmmaking. They were both extraordinarily popular. The Dirty Dozen was the biggest moneymaker of 1967, and repeat business for Bonnie and Clyde was so extensive that Variety, the industry trade magazine, couldn't effectively track its box office performance and wound up placing it in an impossible-to-project category. The picture's popularity placed it on Variety's weekly list of the top dozen box office earners 22 times, a record topped only at that time only by Mary Poppins. The Sergio Leone trilogy, A Fistful of Dollars for a Few Dollars More, and The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, which were also all released in 1967 and 68, that trilogy was also quite commercially successful. And this set of films showed that the industry could make a lot of money from filming extreme violence. And so it escalated with Sam Peckinpah's The Wild Bunch in 1969, and the escalation really hasn't stopped since. The changes to the production code and rating system, in combination with the aesthetic standards set by the films of the late 1960s, opened the possibility for an elaborate and enduring cinematic style to develop. And at this point, it has solidified into two main forms of representing extreme violence. One style consists of squib work, multi-camera filming, and montage editing, as typified by the clip that you just saw, and more recently by the work of director John Woo, among others. The other style consists of graphic imagery of bodily mutilation, eye gouging, impalement, dismemberment, that characterized the resurgence of the horror genre in the 1980s, especially as enabled by developments in special effects such as prosthetic limbs and latex. Many of the new horror films were slasher films about serial killers slaughtering promiscuous teenagers. A basic slasher film premise was a male killer stalking and slaughtering female victims, and the extended subjective camera work in these films, showing the killer's point of view as he stalks his victims, seemed to invite viewers to accompany the killers and to participate in their stalking rituals. And I want to show you a clip from a film that typifies this, because the style of point of view camera work that this film really establishes is very important for what follows after. So here's a clip from Halloween, which was directed by John Carpenter and came out in 1978. You can roll that.
Let happen goblins and broomsticks and ghosts, coven's of witches with all of their hosts. You may think they scare me, you're probably right. Black cats and goblins on
Halloween night. Trick or treat! My parents won't be home until
10. Are you sure? We are alone, aren't we?
Michael's around someplace. Take off that thing.
Let's go upstairs.
Okay.
I'm not going to show the whole sequence, but basically what happens is that the boyfriend leaves without seeing the murderer, and he puts on a mask so that the point of view camera work is even more strongly emphasized, because you can just see through two eye holes, essentially, and then goes up and murders the young woman. Now, the prominence of subjective or point-of-view camera work in serial killer horror films is particularly interesting in the context of two contemporary sites of violent imagery, video games and television news. The threat and loss of distance between the viewer and the film that concerned researchers in the 1930s is clearly exploited in the clip from Halloween, but it also defines the most popular genre of video games today, which are known as first-person shooter games. What this means is that the player sees the action taking place, which consists mainly of bodies being chased and shot, but the player only sees the hands and weapons of the character that they are playing. Their own body is never on screen. They are both immersed in the action and safely outside of its consequences. So what you see on the screen is basically, you know, an arm and a gun holding it, and whatever your character is moved to look at by the joystick. So it's important to note that the subject position occupied by these video gamers is the same as that of the serial killer in many horror films, and that's where the genre convention was really formalized. Significantly, it's not the point of view occupied by the female protagonist who sometimes fights back and escapes. Many researchers who are concerned with the effects of violent imagery on children today have found that occupying this first-person perspective has especially negative consequences in terms of affecting the player's behavior after the fact. Now, interestingly, the US government has come to the same conclusion, but it has viewed the powerful impact of such games as incredibly effective for the purpose of training troops. In fact, in August 1999, the Pentagon awarded $45 million to the University of Southern California to establish the Institute of Creative Technologies, an interdisciplinary team of military and Hollywood people who would work together to develop virtual reality training tools for the Army. The project was specifically designed to mobilize Hollywood techniques of storytelling for the purpose of eliciting the soldiers' emotional engagement with the act of killing in response to threat. As a project participant from the Walt Disney Company explained, if you want to make someone frightened, it is not sufficient to show them a frightening picture. You have to spend a lot of time setting them up with the right music, with cues, with camera angles, so that you are emotionally preparing them, cueing them, getting them ready to be frightened, so that when you put that frightening picture up, they are startled. One of the key strategies for setting up such a convincing virtual environment is putting the viewer or player in the first-person position. Now, the contrast between the government's endorsement and underwriting of these games and its frequent criticism of graphic sex and violence in popular culture is striking, especially given the visual culture that has been generated by the current war in Iraq. So, to conclude by way of the Gulf War, the points that I want to bring to bear from my previous examples are that only certain types of violent imagery get classified as excessively graphic, and that this determination often has a lot to do with whether or not those suffering the violence have sufficient social power to effectively demand that such representations cease. That the criteria for determining what constitutes excessively graphic violence changes over time. That one of the most historically consistent and powerful forces of change in definitions and representations of violence seems to be the social fallout from US military policy, and that therefore the existence of actual violence in the world must always be considered in relation to the question of mass media representations of violence. Now, the first Gulf War is often described as a postmodern war, because it was brought to home viewers through high-tech visual images that resembled nothing so much as a video game, and because it was available around the clock on cable television through CNN. Television coverage of that war is also frequently criticized as being so heavily restricted by military censors that it could only serve as a mouthpiece of the Pentagon. After the unrestricted movement of reporters in Vietnam led to the public display of unflattering images of disorderly and disgruntled troops, an unclear and fragmented mission, and poor military leadership, the Pentagon ensured that press coverage of the first Gulf War would be severely limited in terms of reporters' freedom of access. This policy was widely criticized after the war ended, leading to a new public relations policy for the current Gulf War, embedded reporters. Now, the practice of embedding reporters is both strategically brilliant and deeply unsettling. The brilliance of the strategy is that it places the embedded reporters in the first-person shooter position, while simultaneously eliciting the viewer's sympathy for the innocent civilian placed in harm's way. with reporters often including descriptions of the hardship of combat as they endured it in their reports, viewers are positioned to identify with the reporter's point of view, and thus with the soldier's point of view. In contrast, in a typical newscast, the anchor controls the privilege of direct address. He, or occasionally she, looks and speaks directly to the camera, whereas lower-ranked reporters are only afforded this power once the anchor has directed his virtual gaze at them. Interview subjects are never permitted the discursive power of direct address. They're always shot looking off-screen, presumably at the reporter who is conducting the interview. This system of representation ensures a hierarchical authority structure, with the most persuasive powers of assertion accruing to the speaker with direct access to the audience through direct address. In contrast, by eliminating the usual gap between anchor reporters and their subjects, the practice of embedding allows the military to speak directly to the camera and to regulate our perspective accordingly. And I want to show you my final clip, which is a brief ABC News clip from April 2003.
Sanctions. There's been a running battle whether Saddam Hussein or the outside world is to blame for Iraq's poverty. One thing is clear, as ABC's Ted Koppel saw today, Saddam Hussein spent a lot of cash on himself.
You know, sometimes, Peter, it takes television, to prove, to demonstrate to the world, as you have just indicated with Brother Engel there, to prove what has been denied by the Iraqis. U.S. commanders have been increasingly frustrated these last few days as they rack up one military success after another, only to have the Iraqis deny that it ever happened. Well, that's one of the reasons why the U.S. military allowed us to come along. Major General Buford Blunt, who hopes one of these days to build his retirement home on a lakefront lot in Hattiesburg, Mississippi, rolled up to one of Saddam Hussein's palaces this afternoon.
Yeah, we're here.
And was taken on a tour by one of the 3rd Infantry Division's brigade commanders.
Well, this will be a salvage company's dream. I don't think there will be too much to rebuild here. This was quite a nice room in its heyday. It's more of an administrative building with guest rooms. It looked like it had been cleaned out by the Iraqis. Just bare furniture, a few books, a few office supplies in the desks, and that's about it. It's been completely cleaned out by the Iraqis. There were a few drinking glasses and the nice crystal cigar ashtrays at most of all the place settings here. But you see it right now, just as we found it yesterday when we occupied this room. Every single bathroom in this palace, and there are quite a number of them.
So the clip goes on to give a tour of the palace, concluding with the discovery of Saddam Hussein's videotape collection, in which it was discovered that apparently he was very fond of Hollywood movies. Okay, so what we see here is the adoption of a mode of representation that was originally developed to represent the point of view of serial killers stalking their victims, which was then adapted for first-person shooter video games, which were themselves adapted for use in military training exercises, and which are now structuring the representational format of network news. I think this is significant because the types of representation that are usually singled out for criticism are those produced for entertainment purposes. But the linkages between the representational techniques of the film and television industries and the representational consequences of military policy are rarely considered. Reports of the circulation of pirated Hollywood movies, such as Black Hawk Down, that were re-edited on videotape in Iraq to promote attacks on American troops, suggest that Hollywood may be assisting the U.S. military in war training techniques, but it is also unwittingly assisting Iraqi insurgents. Other popular Hollywood movies have had new soundtracks added by popular Iraqi singers who promote attacks on the U.S. military in their lyrics. This strategy of using Western popular culture against itself, so to speak, contrasts sharply with the strategy of total military control over the images that reach the U.S. viewing audience from embedded reporters. But as the recent photographs from Abu Ghraib have shown, that strategy of containment can never be totally successful. Despite the fact that the Pentagon has prevented journalists from broadcasting images of flag-draped coffins returning from Iraq, the images of prisoner abuse could not be censored. While many events in the war in Iraq have prompted debate about the appropriateness of broadcasting graphically violent images on television, questions about the relationship between documentary images generated in the context of war and fictional images generated to distract viewers from war have rarely surfaced. So I'd like to conclude by asking if a film like Birth of a Nation were to be made about Iraq, whose violence would be included and whose would be censored? Thank you.
And I'm sure when Bonnie and Clyde came out, everyone said, this is it, there's no going any further.
Yeah.
Obviously they have. Are we going to see further extrapolation?
Well, I mean, given what you see in Hollywood blockbusters now, it's hard to imagine there being more guns in a specific film, in an individual film. So with gun violence, I don't know that that can go that much farther, and that was one of the things that people really noticed about Bonnie and Clyde. But of course, the other thing they noticed was the graphic representation of the bodies, you know, being mutilated. And you still see, to a great degree, Hollywood movies showing little consequence to the kinds of violence that take place. So a sequence like that that really slows things down and just shows you in great detail what is happening to their bodies is not that common in Hollywood films now. There's much more emphasis on sort of fetishizing the display of weaponry and not so much on the people who are getting killed. So, you know.
There's water to bring, but I guess forks don't count.
Yeah.
This is for the benefit of the videotape.
How does violence play into reality television? Do you see that becoming another way that violence would perpetrate our culture? And if so, how much?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I mean, the violence that takes place in reality TV is a little bit different in the sense that the equivalent, I think, in that kind of programming is bodily humiliation, which most of these programs are concerned with in some way or another. So, you know, the shows like Fear Factor exemplify this, where people, the whole point of it is to see people doing disgusting or dangerous things with their bodies. And that, to me, seems to be the kind of equivalent, the fascination with the possibility that something could go wrong in one of these situations. If it's not that, the closest thing in some of the more subdued programs would just be the hope to capture on television the moment when someone breaks down and cries or has some kind of, you know, hysterical outburst, which is really what governs the intrigue of these films to begin with. So it's not violence in the same way, you know, it's not gun violence or anything like that, but it definitely has to do with seeing bodies in pain in a particular way.
Yeah, I guess this question is kind of related because I'm thinking about how you would fit into your scheme there, or the phenomenon in the 80s, I guess it was, or the late 70s of snuff films,
mm-hmm.
where there was sort of, I mean, I'm not sure there even was any real snuff films, but there was this whole discussion about how they existed and they were circulating. And how does that fit into this notion of violence that you're working with?
Well, there was a series called Faces of Death. Is this what you're thinking of? There was a series of underground videotapes, basically, that circulated in the 1980s called Faces of Death that were supposedly snuff films, just collections of snuff films. And they were really low quality production values. And, you know, it was always unclear where they came from or whether they were really snuff films or not. But nonetheless, they circulated very broadly. That's what we get in a lot of the television news coverage of these beheadings, for instance, and network coverage of that as well. So, I mean, it seems, and that's one of the things that I was thinking of and thinking about, you know, suggesting that it's important to think about real world violence in relation to the kinds of violent imagery that are in entertainment programming, because, you know, on the nightly news in very recent months, you can see images akin to those sorts of snuff films, but on the nightly news. and it's not meant to be for entertainment purposes, and yet people watch the news regularly and not just for information. So,
yeah, I guess maybe I'm wrong, but I guess that at least part of the snuff film phenomenon was the idea that there was an unwitting victim that was, as it were, an actress, presumably, or an mm-hmm. actor, who was enticed into this role and in a standard sort of violent film, but in the end, the violence turned real, or it was an actual killing at the end. So I just, maybe that was only a rumor that this was what was going on, but the very idea seems to confirm at least something about the penchant toward increased representation of violence, so the line between representation and reality is effaced at that point.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, a lot of similar questions were raised about footage of beheadings as well, right, that circulated on the internet especially. It seemed that there were some that were produced that were fake, that were meant to serve the same purpose as the ones that were real. So the question of, you know, what purpose these sorts of images served and why people wanted to see them as well is one that, you know, I think is important to think about.
I really enjoyed your talk. It was very illuminating. I'm just wondering about the implications of what you said at the end about occupying that first-person position, and specifically the moral implications of that, or what sort of moral argument one might want to make about that. I mean, are you saying that occupying that position is morally condemnable in a way that being the sort of anonymous third person, absent, outside of the frame observer wouldn't be? I'm just wondering about some of those ethical questions. And I know, I mean, you probably don't have like an answer to that, but I'm just wondering if you've thought about that at all, particularly because what you're saying about that resonates with some of what you were saying about the production code of the 30s and that notion of contamination mm-hmm. by being immersed and so forth.
Right. Yeah. Well, I mean, I think the status of the first person position is really contradictory, because on the one hand, you would think to occupy that position would make you think more about the accountability of your actions in a way. You could imagine that that would be the consequence, that you being in the role of the shooter would make you think about who you're shooting or how much you're shooting or why you're shooting or something like that. But it seems that because there is always a certain kind of safe distance there, even though at the same time there's a much more easily imagined immersion in the action, it seems that it enables a kind of pleasure without any of the consequences of that. I wouldn't say that this is always everywhere the same, or that these consequences always follow from, you know, playing violent video games. But it does seem that consistently occupying that point of view has a much more powerful effect, and representing someone occupying that point of view as well has a much more powerful effect in engaging viewer identification.
Kristen, I wonder if you could say something about subcultures of violence. The turning point for me came when I saw the first Terminator film in Baltimore, whenever that was, in the middle 80s. Mm-hmm. And as Arnold turned more and more robot-like and the film became more and more violent, the audience seemed to enjoy it and started laughing.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, they were following the violence as almost like a cartoon.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems to me that filmmakers are also scripting violence to appeal to certain subcultures now that don't really believe in violence anymore. They just want to see a certain kind of graphic on the screen. Is there something going on there at the subcultural level?
Well, I mean, it's definitely true. You know, researchers who are trying to understand the relationship between representations of violence and its consequences, when they look at how people respond to films, it's generally a very small percentage of the research sample that actually react to representations of violence in the way that the researchers are worried they would, which is essentially by, you know, becoming more violent themselves. And then there is a vast majority of viewers who have a vast variety of responses to this kind of thing. And so there are definitely viewers who have a certain level of, I don't know if you would call it sophistication, but a certain kind of engagement with these sorts of images, such that there's not a great deal of danger that after seeing Pulp Fiction, they're going to want to go out and shoot a bunch of people. So that kind of, and I think Quentin Tarantino's work in particular falls into the category of the sorts of films that you're describing, in the sense that these films, they aestheticize violence in a certain way, but in the context of a kind of film that is itself so stylized that that becomes part of the pleasure of watching in a way, because it seems almost contradictory to have something like extreme graphic violence in the context of a film that otherwise could pass as an art film or something like that. So, I mean, I think, but of course, this is also true for viewers of The Terminator. You know, you don't have to want to go out and kill people to enjoy watching a film like that. That's partly, though, because of the ways that I think audiences have been trained over time to be able to be somewhat immune to seeing that level of violence on screen in a way that audiences weren't really prepared for with Bonnie and Clyde, which is why it made such a big impact.
I was like, the willingness to present violence is ooching down into areas that are formerly wasn't considered entertainment, considered news.
Okay, yeah. Well, I think that print media and moving images work very differently in this realm. And I think that it's, you know, in the same way that the reformers talked about the audience self-selectivity of newspapers, plays, and so forth in the 1930s, it seems that there's something sort of similar going on with this kind of thing now, in the sense that, I don't know, most people I don't think read the New York Times just for mindless entertainment. You know, for a sort of pleasure that you can get from watching films or television programs that represent corpses, you know, or something along those lines, but in a context that makes it seem pleasurable in some way. So, I mean, as far as what is shown in newspapers and what gets shown in film and television, I think that they occupy pretty different realms.
I also really enjoyed your talk. And I guess my question kind of follows from Lynn's a little bit, but also from my own experience of living in Europe during this last war, and seeing the different images that were daily shown in European newspapers versus American newspapers. And my question is whether among journalists or media studies people, the debate about the effect of violent images is actually contextualized, as you suggest it should be, that is to say, in terms of the point of view or that is being presented. So mm-hmm. that, for example, if you have embedded reporters and at the same time censor flag-draped coffins, corpses of civilians, or dead American soldiers, the representation of the war is dramatically different and, in fact, inaccurate, mm-hmm. because you're then in the video game position, right? You're allowed right. to identify from a safe distance without ever having to confront the actual effects of the violence that is being perpetrated all around you. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, does that context, the context that you've sketched out here, does that shape debates among journalists themselves about when they decide to allow themselves to be embedded, or is that an academic debate only, or?
No, I don't think it's only an academic debate. I mean, there's a key distinction between what journalists themselves talk about and want to be able to represent and what corporate management will allow. And this is one of the problems that comes up repeatedly in these kinds of situations. So I don't think it's the case necessarily that the journalists who have been embedded assumed from the start that therefore, once they were embedded, they wouldn't be able to kind of control their own form of representation at all. And I think oftentimes the possibility that something unexpected might happen, which might allow for a different perspective, is something that
journalists hope for often, but the kind of contradiction between having the embedded reporters and censoring the flag-draped coffins and, you know, anything that the that the embedded reporters might shoot that might be deemed inappropriate, it still very much governs the way that the mass media as a whole operate. And, you know, I don't think that will change until there is more of a distance between the interests of corporate management and, you know, the interests of power in Washington.
I have wondered many times about the importance of discerning reality from fantasy in terms of human development and evolution. And clearly, from our perspective, people that lived thousands of years ago often lived in a religious fantasy that we consider totally out of touch. Yeah. And yet, as I'm looking at today's culture with increasing comments that news is entertainment, and your topic about emotional possession, I'm wondering, are we getting any better at discerning between reality and fantasy, or do you perceive us, as you study this subject, as going the other way?
Well, I think that definitions of reality are always in flux, and they change a lot depending on the medium that the form of reality is being represented in. I mean, one thing that immediately comes to mind in relation to your question is the extent to which clips from Hollywood films are sometimes used on television newscasts when there isn't any documentary file footage of whatever it is that's being represented. And this happens fairly regularly, and there will be, you know, a little acknowledgement at the bottom of the screen that that's going on, but that won't prevent the use of a fictional representation to demonstrate some part of a story that's being told that doesn't have an audiovisual representation to go along with it. And I mean, what that says to me is that there is the modes of representation that we have for supposedly representing reality and supposedly representing fiction are not very clearly separated. And the style of, for instance, shooting and editing network television news is borrowed from a classical Hollywood style of camera work and editing. And on the one hand, you might say, you know, well, that doesn't necessarily change what it is that they're showing. But on the other hand, it definitely blurs the boundaries between styles of representation that we can look at and clearly define as documentary or real in some way, and those that we look at and see as fictional. So the extent to which even just the styles of representation between forms that are trying to be realistic and forms that are not, the extent to which those blur, and it goes in both directions, I think that just underlines the extent to which these are not realms that, you know, actually occupy very separate areas in our world. And I think the reality television point, you know, that goes to the same point.
So you've discussed a number of trends, starting from early film through more recent trends, more violence, etc. Where do you see it going in the future? What's going to be the next big, you know, if you were giving this talk 20 years from now, well, where would you be going next?
That's hard to say. I mean, the trend certainly seems to be toward more and more graphic representation, and to allowing coverage, for instance, on television of more and more extreme forms of images, on the one hand. On the other hand, the importance of regulation and censorship really hasn't diminished very much. I mean, it takes different forms, but it's still very much an important factor that functions alongside this seeming drive to show more and more graphic content. So, I mean, it seems like the sorts of things that we see now might very well be the sorts of things that we see in 20 years, but given a particular historical context, there might be certain kinds of images of beheadings, for instance, that come to seem appropriate to show on television because they happen all the time or something like that. I mean, it's sort of hard to say what direction things will go in television news, because I think that has a lot to do with, you know, political history and that sort of thing. In Hollywood, Like I said earlier, I mean, I'm sure that graphic violence will continue to be a really important selling factor, but it's sort of hard for me to imagine how it could get more extreme than it is right now, although I'm sure it probably could.
Let's go with two more, and then we'll give Kirsten a breather.
Kirsten, I've been interested in the large number of personal videos that make the news ever since the Rodney King trial and so forth, and these are on the scene, live action shootings or activities of violence, which later on end up being in virtually overturned by eyewitnesses when the courts rule that, oh, well, what's in that video really didn't actually happen that way. It's something different. Do you sense that there's going to be an increased skepticism on the part of viewers as more and more and more kinds of imagery enters our daily lives, whether from everything from news and movies to internet and video games and billboards and whatnot? Do you think there'll be a disconnect where people just won't believe anymore what they see, because I've seen a number of studies about the disconnect that we all have, that we think we've seen things when we haven't seen them, but here you come up with the camera and it just shows it right there. What's the thinking on this kind of?
Yeah, I mean, I think that since the development of digital photography, especially the general public's ability to or willingness to believe in any photographic image has been dwindling, you know, and it continues to. And I think the proliferation of so-called documentary images through reality television furthers that in a way, because it makes the whole category of documentary suspect and seem like just a form of entertainment. And, you know, those shows are accompanied by exposés on how fake reality television actually is and so forth, so that it does propel this sense that you can't believe any form of visual representation that you see, either because it's staged or because it can be easily manipulated through technology. On the other hand, I don't think that the general desire to see visual proof of something as the way of ascertaining its reality has gone away at all, which is, you know, why we do still have all of these programs, even though everyone believes that they're fake, you know, but still reality television goes on as it does, and people sort of willingly suspend their disbelief. And this is true for the news, too. I mean, I can't imagine it ever, this scenario that you're talking about, ever leading to a time when television news has no video footage, for instance. You know, and I think it's precisely because of this sort of contradictory desire, despite the recognition that it's very hard to place faith in photographic realism.
Last question. Cheers, Lisa.
Hi. We've been talking, I guess, mostly about human-on-human violence here, but it seems recently there's been a tremendous amount of fascination in natural disaster as a form of violence, and we've been inundated with these images on television and internet news. Repetitions of tsunami violence and mudslide violence, which we may not associate with the kinds of, let's say, filmic interpretations that you've been talking about here. But why are we so fascinated with this type of violence as well? It seems there's some kind of correlation between the two.
Since the very earliest days of film theory, people have believed that there's something about the appeal of first photographic imaging, and then even more so moving images captured on film. There's a fascination to these sorts of representations because it seems in some way to cheat death, in the sense that, you know, once something is preserved on film, it could live forever. The parallel to that, though, has been a sense that often people are especially interested in events with human figures in them captured on film because of the possibility that you might get to see the thing that you never actually get to see happening in real life, which is death. And it seems, and there's been a lot of discussion about how this works in, for instance, in coverage of catastrophes on television, not like the tsunami, but like airplane crashes and
or
that
NASCAR.
Sort of thing. Yeah, exactly, right. So, you watch with the possibility held out before you that you could see something that you're not supposed to see and that, you know, we don't generally expect to see and that we don't necessarily want to see on a certain level, but that nonetheless holds a really powerful fascination. So that seems to be very much at play in the kind of perhaps morbid draw to these sorts of images.
It sounds like we like it.
Yes.